Chem 122 students, my name is Professor Amanda Hudson, and I'm going to be walking you through the Iodine Clock lab today. So this is a lab that we're going to look at the kinetics of a lab, so reaction rates. For this one, we're going to be using a reaction with iodine and whatever S2O8 is, persulfate, and we're going to measure how varying the concentration of these two reactants is going to change the speed of the reaction. Okay, so let's get in. Okay, so our iodine clock reaction is here. We have 2I minus plus S2O8 2 minus, which yields I2 and 2SO4. So if we were to write the rate of the reaction, the rate would be equal to our K, our constant, times the concentration of iodine raised to its order, which we'll call M. Then we have the concentration of S2O8 raised to its order, which we'll call M. So the purpose of the lab today is to be able to complete this rate law. So we're going to be determining K, M, and N today. Oops, sorry, this is an N. K, M, and N. Okay, so the way we're going to do that is we're going to run three different reactions here. So in our reaction 1 and 2, the concentration of S2O8 is the same. So I have those indicated here with 1. So we're going to keep this constant, so we're going to be able to determine the order of the iodine here. And then in our reactions 2 and 3, the concentration of iodine is going to be constant, and we'll be able to determine the rate or the order of S2O8. So when we're doing this, the rate for the reactions is going to be equal to the change in the concentration. We're using I2, and so we're using the concentration of I2 to determine our rate. So the change in concentration of I2 over the change in time. So delta I2 over delta T. Okay, so important to note, in order for this to work, in order for us to determine the order here, we have to keep the temperature constant. So for all three of our reactions, the temperature is the temperature of our lab, which is at 19 degrees Celsius. In the second part of the lab, you're going to see how a changing temperature will affect the rate, but for this first part of it, we're at constant temperature of 19. Okay, so another important thing to note here, these concentrations of I and S2O8, these are not the concentrations given in the lab, and they're not the concentrations on the bottle. So what happens is you're going to see in the lab, there's a beaker with I in it, and there's another container with the S2O8. And we're going to mix those two together, and that starts the reaction. So what's going to happen is after we combine those two together, that's going to determine our concentration. So in order to do that, we're going to have to recall that in order to solve for the concentration of I and S2O8, we're going to have to use our mixing formula, where M1V1 equals M2V2. Okay, so our molarity of our iodine is given in the lab. So the molarity M1 is 0.200 molar. Okay, so that's the same for all of them. We're taking it from the same container. The volume varies whether you're doing reaction 1, 2, or 3. So the volume 1 is going to be what's being pipetted into the glassware. So that's either the 10 milliliters or it's the 20 milliliters. M2, this is what we're solving for, and M2 is what we would have in our table here. And our V2, this is our total volume, so volume total, which for all of our reactions here is the 50 milliliters. Okay, so you're going to plug in your M1 of 0.2. Again, whichever reaction you had, you either had 10 milliliters of the iodine or 20. Our total volume is 50, and you will solve for M2. And these are the values will be in the table here. So you'll have the concentration of I1 here for reactions 2 and 3. Iodine will be the same for these two. And for the S208, the concentration of S208 will be the same in 1 and 2, and it will be different in experiment 3. Okay, so this is essentially the reaction here. We're going to go over how we solve for the rate in just a moment, but there is a second reaction going on in this experiment, so I do want to take a look at that. So we'll call this one the clock reaction. So we know we're going to get our final time by looking for a color change. So once we see this very sort of dramatic color change, we know to stop our experiment, and that's going to give us our time. So the reaction that produces a color change is on a delay. So the color change comes from an iodine binding with starch in the solution, and that's going to give us sort of this dark blue color change. Before that, we want it to kind of be on a delay, because as soon as iodine is produced, the color change happens, which isn't very, you know, good for timing anything. So what we have is a delay, and we use S203 for that. So it will react with the I2 before it can bind with starch. So we're going to put in a known amount of S203 so that we have a known amount of I2 that reacted. And we're going to be able to calculate this. And we'll go over that in just a little bit. So it will react before the starch binds to produce the color change. So what this does here is it gives us a delay. Okay, so the iodine will react with this first. And then once iodine is produced, once this is all gone, then we start reacting with the starch to produce the color change here. Okay, so what this is going to mean is the time is going to be different for each of the three experiments we run. The mechanism is the same. The only thing that's going to change is how fast the iodine is produced to react with this here. So if iodine is produced very quickly, it's going to react with the S203 very quickly, and we're going to get a shorter final time. If the I2 is produced slowly, it's going to take longer to react and consume the S203, and we're going to get a longer final time for that. So that's what's going to change our rate, is our final time, how fast the iodine is produced to react, or how slow the iodine is produced to react here.
Milliliters of the potassium iodide, 10 milliliters of filler liquid, 10 milliliters of thiosulfate, sulfate, and we're going to add now 20 milliliters of persulfate, and needs to click start at the same instant the two touch. Okay, we are going to now do run number 2.
Now that the experiment is done, the rest of the data table needs to be filled in based off of calculation. So we're going to need to calculate the rate, and then we're going to need to use that information to calculate our M and N values, and then finally our constant K. Okay, so let's start with the rate. So the rate of the reaction is going to be the change in the concentration of our iodine over our change in temperature. Okay, so these deltas, these changes mean we have the concentration of I2 final subtract the concentration of I2 initial over T final and T initial, or T at time zero. Okay, so a couple of these are easy. So when the reaction starts, we have iodine as a product. So when the reaction starts, there's none of this. So this turns out to be zero molar. And then at when we start our reaction, the time is zero. So this one drops out also, and we have 0 seconds here. So this condenses down our rate into just the concentration of iodine final over our time final. And this time final is the time you got from the stopwatch in the video. So that's our final time. That's when we got that color change. Okay, so we set up the experiment to where the concentration of I2 when that color change happened is the exact same for experiments 1, 2, and 3. So in all of our experiments, so in each, we'll say beaker, so in each beaker, we pipetted in 5 × 10⁻⁵ moles of S2O3. Okay, so after this is consumed, that's when we get our color change that happens. So we want to know how much I2 was consumed at this point as well. So if you do a little stoichiometry, you see that this is 2.5 × 10⁻⁵ moles of I2 were consumed. Okay, so we just need to turn this into a concentration. Again, this is the same for each beaker. They're all set up where we put, again, the same amount in. It fully reacts. After it reacts, we get that color change. So we want to know how much iodine had reacted. So again, using our clock reaction stoichiometry, we can get that 2.5 × 10⁻⁵ moles of I2 were consumed at that point. Okay, so that's moles. We need to turn this into a concentration. So the concentration will be just divided by the total volume of our reaction, which was 50 milliliters or 0.05 liters. So this is our I2, our concentration of I2 for each and every one of those reactions. That's all the same. So the only thing that's going to change is that value that came from the stopwatch, or that TF. Okay, so let's get a new sheet here. So now our rate becomes, for each one of the reactions, our rate is our 2.5 × 10⁻⁵ mole of I2 over that 0.050 liter divided by the T stopwatch. So after you solve this, we have concentration, we have moles per liter. So we have a concentration unit in the top, and our stopwatch was given in seconds. So our units for our rate, moles per liter per second, which is what we need. So this is the same for each of them. And again, the only thing that's going to be different is that final time that we got there. Okay, so next, after the rate, we are going to need to calculate our M and N values. So this is a little tougher. It's going to involve a little bit of using some logs. So let's set that up. So let's look at the rate law again. Okay, so let's say we wanted to determine our order for our iodine. So if we look back at our chart that we had initially, which I don't know what I did with that, but over here. So if we go back and look at our chart, we want to choose two reactions to where we can eliminate any variables we can. So because the concentration of S2O8 is the same in experiments 1 and 2, we want to choose those because S2O8 is not going to have any effect on any sort of differences in the rate we see. So if we choose those are constants that gets eliminated, and we're only looking at effects of the rate being on the change in concentration of iodine. So we're going to use experiments 1 and 2. Okay, so 1 and 2, and this is going to help us identify what the order for iodine is, or the M. Okay, so we're gonna have then our rate that we just previously calculated for reaction two divided by our rate for reaction one. When we divide these two, we're gonna get K and S2O8 that would be eliminated. So if we set this up, here, let's go do it, equals K I minus to the M and S2O8 two minus to the N. This is one, And then this is, set up our other rate law, K one, S2O8. Okay, so if we look at what we have here, our K is constant. So when we divide these two, K is canceled out. So since our concentration of iodine is different, so we have concentration of iodine 2, concentration of iodine 1, that one doesn't cancel. But since here, again, this concentration didn't change, so whatever you calculated this in your initial table, this is the same, so this gets eliminated as well. So if we, by doing this, we can reduce it down to the differences in rate we see. So rate from experiment 2 over rate from experiment 1 is equal to the changes in concentration of the iodine. Okay, so dividing, that all reduces down to this here. Okay, so now the tricky part is isolating the M, and this is where kind of using some logs is going to come in here. Okay, so rate 2 over rate 1. Since these are both to the same exponent, this turns into concentration of iodine 2 over the concentration of iodine 1 raised to the M. So I can bring those into the fraction and raise it to the M. Now, since this is an exponent and it's the unknown, we have to take logs to get rid of this. So we're gonna take the log of both sides. So we have log of rate number 2 over log of rate number 1 equals the log of the concentration of iodine in experiment 2 over the concentration of iodine in experiment 1 to the M. Okay, so this from here. Okay, so now we can use some properties of logs and do a little bit of rearranging of things. So I can take this and bring it over as a coefficient. So this will be equal to M log I2 over I1. And now, so you'll have values for this. Again, these will come from your table. You will have calculated this. This will come from your table. So now to just get M by itself, to isolate M on this side, we can just divide this over. Okay, so to finish that up, we'll have M then is equal to our log of rate number 2 over the log, or of rate number 1 divided by the log of I2 minus from experiment 2 over I2 minus from experiment 1. Okay, so your rates then you calculated, and again, these you calculated are in your table as well. Okay, so let's kind of put this back here. Again, finishing this up. Dividing through to, again, eliminate all of the information we don't need to get this form of it here. And then again, just using a little bit of algebra to solve for M, using some properties of logs, taking this over, and then again, we get this final one here. So you can do the same thing to solve for N with S2O8. So you'll have to do the same thing here, but instead of using experiments 1 and 2, you're going to use experiments 2 and 3 where iodine is constant. So you can eliminate the iodine, you can go through the same math, and you can solve for N. Okay, so that will get us our concentrations, or our M and N, so our orders of iodine. Then you're gonna need to solve for K. So again, if you go back and write your rate law, rate equals K, concentration of I to the M, S2OH2- to the N. At this point, after you solve for M and N, you can put those in. So if they're first order, you put in ones, second order, put in twos, whatever you need to do here. You'll have rates, so just choose an experiment. So say choose experiment one, put your rate for experiment one in, put your concentration of iodine for experiment one, and put your concentration of S2O8 for experiment one. Then you'll have your M and N values, and then you can solve for K. So you'll do that for experiments one, two, and three. Since K is a constant, if you did a really good job in this experiment, they should all be very, very similar. Okay, so the last part of this lab is going to look at changing temperature and how that affects the rate constant. So there's a lot of data given to you in this lab. So you've been given sort of the dry lab portion of this. There isn't a video you need to watch for this part of it. So you're going to kind of go through the same steps that you did in part A. They're going to give you the time. You're going to calculate the rate the exact same way you did in part A. But again, the times have been given to you. And again, it's important to note, again, in part B, that the temperature is different for each of the experiments that they ran for this one. So at the end, you're going to find the activation energy. So you'll go through the steps of this. You're going to find the activation energy for the for this experiment here. Okay, so to find the activation energy, we are going to use the Arrhenius equation. So we're going to use the Arrhenius equation where we get the linear function of it. So to graph our K and T and to get a straight line, we graph the ln K equals negative EA over R times 1 over T plus ln of A. So this is the linear form of the Arrhenius equation, where again, if we were to graph our 1 over T and our natural log of K, we would get a straight line. So for the dry lab part in B, once you graph those points, you will get a nice straight line. So you'll have 1 over T at the bottom in units of Kelvin minus 1, and then you'll have your natural log of K here. Okay, so then you need to find the activation energy of this experiment. So remember, in this form, it's in slope-intercept form. So this is essentially Y, this is M, this is X, and plus B. So to find the activation energy, if we look at this, if we can find the slope, we can find the activation energy here. So once you have your graph of your points, the slope of that line is going to be equal to negative EA over R. So you'll have your three points that you graph. You're going to choose two of them, and you're going to find the slope using, you know, y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1 to find the slope. And then you're going to get your slope from those three points, and then put in R, and then you can calculate the activation energy. So just like you did in the previous week, when you graph this here, you're using the slope form of the Arrhenius equation to find it here. One of the questions asks you about the experiment we did, or you saw in the videos, how that would fit onto this line here. So in order to do that for your experiment, you'll have to get your natural log of K and your 1 over temperature that was given at the beginning of this, and see if it lies on that line there.